Hello everyone, welcome back. Okay, so we will begin the next session. So let us start with strings. Quick recap, we looked at the basic language features that were useful, why Python is important and why we believe it is a useful language to learn. I did not go into too many details, but you should get a rough flavor for what it is. Then we learnt how to start the interpreter, the basic vanilla Python, and then quickly we switched over to the IPython interpreter. And the IPython interpreter, the reason we are doing that is because it is a lot more powerful and offers a lot of features, many of which you have already seen. We have demonstrated, specifically we have demonstrated tab completion, history, in fact it is nicely color syntax highlighted. You can also look at documentation by doing question mark. These three features are extremely useful. In addition to this, there are a variety of other features that IPython offers. If you are interested in looking at these details, please look up on Google for IPython, and there is a plethora of, there is a huge amount of information available on IPython itself. But we will not get into all of those details right here because there is not that much time. And the point, one thing to be noted is one of the goals of this course is not to teach you everything, I mean, because everything cannot be taught. We are trying to get you started and get you to a point where you are comfortable enough that you can do a great variety of things and fish for yourself. We are trying to teach you how to fish so you can go and do it by yourself eventually. So let us move on to strings. What are strings? So anything within quotes is treated as a string. Unlike in C, there is no single character or thing like that. So it basically everything is a string, and you do not have to worry about null terminated and all of that. So basically, to create a string, there are variety of syntaxes, and the reason for all of this variety is to give a lot of programmer convenience. So single quotes will work, double quotes will work, or you can do what are called triple quoted strings. So you put three single quotes or three double quotes as shown in the examples below. So this, for example, is a simple string. You just use a single quote on each side. Remember that it is the same side of the quote, it is this, the one on top of the double quote, the one next to the enter key. Do not put back ticks, that does not have anything to do with the string. Now this is a string too here, this is actually wrong, this is not a string, it should be this. Somehow I overlooked the error yesterday night. Similarly, this triple quoted string is three single quotes, and as is this double quoted string. As you can see, there are a variety of ways by which you can create strings, single quote, double quote, or triple single quote, triple double quotes. We will look at the details in a little while. So why so many? Because it reduces the need for escaping. So supposing I want to say Python's, so look at the apostrophe S here, so that is again a quote. So you cannot, in normal C you will have to put a, you will have to escape this quotation mark. So whereas when you use a double quote, you can put a single quote inside as many as you want inside this string, and it will still be one string. So you do not have to escape this. Similarly, if I want to say he said I love Python, and you want to put that in double quotes, you put the original string inside single quotes. The disadvantage with a single quoted string like this is that it cannot span multiple lines. It is only meant for single line quotes. Okay. To do that, you typically will use what are called triple quoted strings, and they can be multi-line. See, for example, I am typing on the shell, S is the quick brown. Notice that when I did this, it said syntax error end of line EOL when scanning string literal, okay, which means it was expecting it to end in the same line. But if I put triple quotes, the quick brown, and now it prompts me for more, fox jumped over the lazy dog, and that is a legal string. And notice it stores the new lines that were actually added. So, this is extremely convenient and it is typically used for documentation that is supplied along with the code itself. So, let us get little more, do more interesting things. Now, with strings, again assignment is straightforward. So, you can assign a variable to a string. Here as you can see, A is hello, B is world, and now you can do simple arithmetic. So, it does what you expect. C is equal to A comma, so that is another string, plus B plus exclamation mark. So, what this does is it creates a new string that basically has all of the information. Sorry, it's distracted. So, C is basically the concatenation of A, which is hello, comma, space, world, finally with an exclamation mark. So, please try this and see what you get. You should get hello, comma, space, world, exclamation mark. So, the plus operator basically does concatenation. Now, what will minus do? Feel free to experiment on the interpreter and find out for yourself. But before you experiment, think for a second and try to see what you think it should do. Strings can be multiplied with numbers. Basically, the idea is it becomes very easy to multiply a string. So, supposing I want to put 20, I want to put a string of stars. Sometimes you want to print something like this. So, if I say star into 80, it will give me 80 columns of print of that string. So, sometimes it is useful. So, if I want to put a line like that, it is easy to do that. So, the point is in this case again when I say A star 5, it basically means A plus A plus A plus A 5 times. Now, what do you think should happen if I do A star 5.5? So, A is hello, so A star 5 will be hello, 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 hello. But what about 5.5? What do you expect? So, if you try it out, you will find that you will get a type error, which basically says it does not know how to multiply a sequence by a non-integer. Okay. Therefore, if it makes sense, typically it will happen. If it does not make sense, it is not going to happen. And if you do not know what it is going to do, please feel free to try it out on the interpreter. As we said before, accessing the elements is as easy as saying A of 0, A of 4. And now notice these two things that I did not cover in the past. So, any sequence you can also access it with negative indices. The idea is, so let us look at A. A is hello. So, hello A of minus 1, what do you expect? It will give me the last element. So, minus 1 will count from the rear, minus 4 will be the fourth element from the rear, which will be O L L E. So, it will be E. Okay. So, indices now can be accessed both ways. Remember what would happen if I said A of 100, it will give me an index error, it will say string index out of range. Similarly, if I give it minus 100, same thing, it is going to give me an out of range. So, you can access the elements of that string, but only the ones that are inside the string. So, the indices have to be valid indices, but can be either positive or negative. Now, if you want to change the element of the string, you might think that I can say given A is this, I want to say A of 0 is F. You cannot do it because strings are considered immutable. Something that is immutable basically means that it cannot be changed. You can manipulate a string to produce a new string. So, when you do A plus B or A into 4 or A into 5 or something like that, it is creating a new string, it is not modifying the same string. So, Python has two classes of objects, two broad classes of objects called immutable and mutable. Integers, floating point numbers, complex numbers, booleans, tuples, all of these are immutable. Strings are also immutable, which means the object cannot be changed. You create a string and that string is basically fixed. You can create a new string using elements of that string, or you can create, you can manipulate the new string, the string, but all of those operations will produce a new string. They will not change the same string. Okay. okay. That is a design decision, it is always like that, okay. So, questioning me about why it is immutable, what is the reason for immutability is beyond the scope of this class. The point is strings are immutable, all you need to remember is that, and it is a design decision that has been made by the benevolent dictator for life, and it proves to be a very useful idea. So, the upshot is we cannot change the string in place, but we can create new strings, okay. So, now let us start with a little problem, okay. The first thing you have to note before we solve this problem is that strings have methods, okay, that can be used to manipulate them. So, what do I mean by methods? So, if you pay attention to the terminal, A is a string. So, type of A is str, okay. If I do A followed by a dot and hit the tab key, you will see a huge number of completions. To go through these completions, you press space, okay, and it will show you all of the completions that are available. For example, there is something called A dot, if I do UP tab, it is called upper. What is upper? To find out, you do what you normally do with IPython, you do question mark. So, A dot upper, so A dot UP tab question mark enter will give you A dot upper. One point to remember, when you do A dot tab, you will get a lot of things, lot of completions, and it will say more in the bottom. So, this is called a pager. If you want to quit this, simply press Q, okay. So, when you do tab or you do question mark and you get more than one page and you want to quit, you press Q. Is this clear? Now, if you do A dot UP tab, you get upper, you do question mark, hit enter, it will tell you that this method returns a copy of the string S converted to uppercase. So, let us try it, S dot upper. So, to call it, you close, open close parenthesis, and it says S dot upper is the quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog, okay. And please notice that S itself has not changed. Whereas, S dot upper returns a new string. Is this clear? So, these are called methods. So, every object in Python has a variety of methods. You would have noticed that on S or A dot tab, there are so many underscore fellows. This is a double underscore, 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 add, underscore, underscore, class, underscore, doc, underscore, EQ. You should ignore all of these underscore methods. In general, in Python, if any method has an underscore or anything has an underscore, it is meant to be a secret method, or it is meant to be a hidden or a private quantity. And as all decent people are, you do not touch other people's private parts. Same way, you do not touch the private parts of any object in Python, unless you know what you are doing, okay. So, given this information, feel free to experiment on your interpreter with various methods to find out what methods do. Again, the key is to press question mark. Anyway, so let us get to the problem. The problem is, we are given a list week, the variable name is week. It contains the names of the days of the week and a string S, which means week is a list containing 7 strings. Each string is like Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, something like that. So, it will be sun, mon or whatever, okay. Now, you are given some other string S, okay, and the string is say Saturday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all of this is may be there in this string. So, the string could be any one of those. We need to check if the string happens to be a day in the week. We should be able to check for any of the forms. We should be able to check for Sat, Saturday. We should not worry about capitalization. So, what we have to do now is, we have to write a little line of code to solve this particular problem. So, I will repeat, we have week is a list, so I will type it out. Okay, or something like that, okay, etc. So, I am just going to close it for now because I do not want to type out all of this. And I am given some S, which is say Sunday, okay. But week need not be this, sir. Week is something you control. So, week is a variable that you have created with a list of 7 strings. Given the list of 7 strings and given any S, so S could be either Sunday or S could be Sun or S could be Sun or S could be whatever it is, I need to know whether that particular string happens to be a day of the week. So, how do we solve this problem? So, obviously, the easiest way to do this is to use only the first 3 characters of the string, okay. Secondly, we have the issue of dealing with all of these cases. We could have capitals, we could have half capital, we could have wrongly typed capitalization, all of that we have to worry about. So, what do we need to do? We need to just convert everything to lower case, in which case everything becomes the same, we do not have to worry about it. Finally, we need to check for existence in the list week, correct. So, we need to check if this S, if the first 3 characters of the string that are converted to lower case, finally, that string we have to check whether it is there inside the week or not, correct. Is everybody with me here? Now, this makes it obvious as to what week should have, correct. I will repeat this. We need to check for all of these possible forms that I have listed here. All of these should be possible. So, which means I need only the first 3 characters, but then I need to convert them to either fully lower or fully upper, whichever one of the 2 I have to convert, because then I completely eliminate the problem of the case. Once I do that, I need to check whether that is inside the week. Therefore, obviously, our week itself should have everything stored in that same representation. So, it should be Sun, Mon, Tu, Ved. Is this clear? Why are we doing this? Does this make sense? So, that is how week should be stored. Now, I give you 5 minutes to figure out how to do the rest. First hint is, remember that S has several methods. So, if you do S dot L tab, you may get some idea, but generally do S dot tab, you will get lots of these methods, okay. Week is this, S could be anything. So, given this, think for 1 minute. I will give you 30 seconds, not even 1 minute, I will give you exactly 30 seconds. You please think up of an answer before we discuss it, because you know everything now about strings necessary to solve this problem. For example, take this case, Friday. So, please do not share your answers immediately, let everybody. The point of this exercise is, I find that often when teaching, it is helpful to do this, to think about the problem and then give your answers. So, once again, the slide is extremely clear. You have to get the first 3 characters of the string. So please don't send your answers to everybody and share the answer. The idea is that you think about the problem before you share it. Okay, so 1 minute is up. If you haven't gotten it by this time, we will be discussing it in a short while. Let us move on. We'll come back to this problem in the next 5 minutes. So if we take Q in this example, hello world, what do you think Q0:3 will be? So stop thinking about the problem now. I have given you enough time to think about it. Just wait for a little while. Q0:3 will give me the first three characters. So if you go back to a previous slide, it says check the first three characters of the string, convert it all to lowercase, check for existence in the list weak. Okay. So to get the first three characters, I can do it in two different ways. I can say 0:3, that gives me hello. Hell. I could also say :3. When you do :3, it means implicitly, if you do not specify the first index, it means, so in this example, :3 suggests that you are not specifying 0. So if you do not specify anything, it means 0. So what do you think 3: will do? Now here is the important part. So Q:3 will give you hello world. So Q:3 plus Q:3 will give me the whole string. This at some level explains why the last index does not include 3, because this syntax makes it extremely easy for me to do this. If I did not have it this way, I will have to say, supposing Q:3 included the third index, I would have to say Q:3, then plus Q:3 plus 1 to the end. So I do not want to do all this plus 1 business here, and therefore this convention of not including the last index makes such things very easy. Okay. So continuing on with slicing, Q:3, open bracket, close bracket, will give me the end of the, from the third, from the actually the fourth value, fourth index to the end. Q, so now supposing, so clearly two things are obvious. If I do not specify the first index, it means 0. If I do not specify the last index, it means to the end, right. So now it stands to reason that if I simply say Q:, what should it do? It should give me from the beginning to the end. So let us try that. Gives me the whole string. So if you want a copy of a sequence, you can simply do Q or whatever that sequence, open bracket, :, close bracket. It will give you a copy of that sequence. Now what do you think the last one is? So let us first try this, Q:3. What do you think this will give me? So before you do something on the interpreter, it is a good idea to predict what you will get. Q:3 will give me what you expect, RLD, because -3 counts from the back, -1 will be D, -2 will be L, -3 will be R. Okay. So what about Q:-1:1? That should give me empty, right? Because from the last element to the second element, there is no way to go. It does not do any wrapping around. However, Q:-1:1 is remove the first element, remove the last element and the remainder. Okay. So this should give you some idea of how to do slicing. So I have just given you a bunch of examples. Okay. So now let us go back, or let us solve this problem. So we need to get the first three characters of the string. So what is our string? It was Friday. This is the week. So I need to get the first three elements. How do I do that? I simply say :3. But unfortunately, it is this stupid capital F, capital R, little I. How do I make it into a lower? Remember that S colon 3 itself is a string, it is an expression that evaluates to a string. So, it has a method, so I can say lower. The only problem is you cannot tab complete in this case, because unfortunately IPython does not know what that slice is going to become, right, unless you make that into a separate variable. So, I can simply do s dot 3 dot s 3 lower, that will give me fri. Now, I do s dot 3 dot lower in weak, the answer is true. So, we have solved our little problem very simply. Please note that I could also do this, x is s colon 3 x dot lower in weak. Okay. Note that if I just do x dot lower, it is meaningless, it is simply the method itself, it is not going to call that function. So, to call that method, you have to supply this argument, you have to supply the parenthesis. Is this clear? So, we have solved a little problem, and I guess most of you must have got at least some elements of it. So, all of this S of someone had typed S of S dot colon 3 and all is that is wrong. Okay. So, you have to do it carefully, and every element, every part of the syntax matters. So, if you make a mistake, the interpreter will shout at you, saying error, syntax error, this is wrong, something it will say. You have to learn to read that error message, deduce what is wrong and fix it, and this is something that comes with practice. So, you have to keep doing it, make mistakes, learn. The important thing is you have to think about the error message and learn to fix it. Okay. So, moving on, so far we have only looked at slicing. What about striding? So, let us come back to our simple example. Q is hello world. So, Q of 0 colon 5 is what? It will give me simply hello. So, what do you think Q of 0 colon 5 colon 1 should be? It means start at the 0th fellow, that is the first H, capital H, go till the 5th minus 1, which is 4th index, which means H 0. E is 1, L is 2, the second L is 3, O is 4, all of those. So, Q 0 colon 5 will give me hello, fine. If I supply an additional colon 1, it says stride by 1, which is exactly the same thing. So, I should get the same answer. But what if I did stride by 2? It will give me H L O. What if I did stride by 3? So, now try the next example, Q of 0 colon colon 2. Now, what do you expect? So, to answer this, first let us answer what happens of Q of 0 colon. We already have seen this. Q of 0 colon will give me the full string. So, if I ignore and do not specify an index, it means to the end. So, if I do colon colon 2, what does it mean? It means give me till the end, but stride by 2. So, HLO WR WRD. What about this 2 colon 2, 2 colon 2 double colon 2, it will start with L, LO word. So, it will start with the third index, which is HEL, first L, skip by 2 till the end of the word. What about this? I am doing this example. Where the mouse is, Q double colon 2, what do you think this should do? Notice that in this case, we have neither specified the first index nor the last index. So, if you do not specify the first index, it defaults to 0. If you do not specify the last index, it specifies to the end of the list, including that last element. Therefore, this will give me first to the last. So, it will be SIL HLO WRD, same answer. How about 5 colon 0 in steps of minus 1? Will this work? It does. So, if you want to reverse the string, you can do it in this fashion, because clearly the syntax here is clear, it is unambiguous, it is correct. I am saying go to the fifth index, start there. What is the fifth index? H E L L O H E L L O, but this, remember this is the fifth index and the index starts at 0. So, when I say 5, it means the sixth element. So, that is space. So, start from the space, go till 0, which is the first element, but do not include the 0, and then step in the reverse direction. So, what if I do not specify the last index? Now it will give me ole in reverse, okay. Is this clear? So, basically with this slice notation, as you can see, is extremely powerful. I can make a copy, I can give you a some sub elements, I can stride by some, I can go positive, I can go negative, so I can reverse, all of these things can be done with stride. So, strides are extremely powerful and it is a very good idea to master how to do striding. So, moving on, this is something we have already seen. So, if you do s dot lower, s dot upper, they will return new strings which will give you lower case and upper case. S dot tab will give you a variety of other methods that you can use. I urge you to try this in your spare time and look at all the methods that you are having available. Please remember though, in all of this, strings are immutable, which means they do not change. You cannot change them in place, so which means I cannot do q of 0 equals a, for example. I cannot do that. And every time you call a method like this, say s dot lower, if it is going to create a string, it is going to return a new string, and you have to keep that in mind. So, the solution to the problem has two solutions actually. One is this, which now you should completely understand. So, s dot lower will give you a lower cased version of s, of which we are finding the first three elements. We are checking if that exists in weak. Similarly, this takes only the first three elements of the string supplied, converts only those elements to the lower, and then checks in weak. So, they are both equivalent solutions that are perfectly applicable. Please note that if the final index, so if you have a sudden question, array, what happens if the final index that you specify is very large? Nothing will happen, it will simply slice till the end. Whatever is available, it will slice and provide. So, q of 0 colon 100 will give you all of the elements. Okay, so let us move on. There are a variety of other methods that string provides. So, there are, if you notice, if you do s dot tab, for ignoring all of these underscore methods, is capitalize, center, count, decode, encode, ends with, index, is alnum, is alpha, blah blah blah, or so you have a variety of these methods, okay. One of whom is what is called join. So, if you look up here, there is something called join. So, given a list of strings, we may want to join them into a single string, okay. However, this is something that is very useful, which is why we are discussing it here. So, supposing I have a list of strings as in given in this example, I have info at fosse.in, enquiries at fosse.in, excuse me, and help at fosse.in. There are three different strings. So, let me make a simpler example. So, I have this string, cheetahs are fast. Cheetahs are fast as three individual strings. So, a of 0 will give me cheetahs, a of 1 will give me r, AF2 will be fast. I now want to assemble a string that is the combination of this. How could I do that? So, I can say A of 0 plus space plus A of 1 plus space plus A of 2, right? And you can immediately see how this is very stupid. It is a very clunky way of doing it. Supposing I have 5 elements, supposing I have only 2 elements, supposing I have only 1 element in that list, supposing I have 3000 elements in that list, how do I do it? I want a mechanism by which I can do this easily. So, the join method allows you to do this very conveniently. All you need to do to this is to say space dot join. Remember, space, the single quoted string, just space is a string, so it has the method join A. Okay. So, now let us, for example, let me create a really long list. It's okay, I won't do it because if I create that, I'll have to introduce new syntax that will confuse all of you. But the point is, if I have a huge list of lines, a huge list of strings, and I want to join them, it's easy to imagine that this is a very very convenient way. But now supposing I don't want to do this as space, I want to put comma space. So it'll say cheetahs comma space r space fast. If I don't want the space, I can do this. Or if I want to say, okay, so as you can see, this makes it extremely convenient. So now supposing I want to say, no, I want it to be with comma, and I want to make it look like a list. So I can say, for example, okay. So, the idea is now I can do very interesting things with this. So, it is a very powerful, very simple command that lets you do join elements of the string. So, it is called join and it is very useful. Okay. So, there is a lot of methods in strings which we are not covering. We urge you to look at either the documentation or just explore on a string. So, just create say Q, look at Q, Q dot tab. And look at each of the methods. So, for example, if you do not understand swap case, do question mark, it will tell you what it is. Or you want to say q dot split, it will tell you what it is. So, each thing will give you, each method will give you documentation with which you can figure out what to do with the string. So, with this we wind up the strings. As I mentioned earlier, our idea is not to teach you everything. Our idea is simply to get you started to be able to do useful things. So, we only teach you say the most useful parts of string that we think will be useful later on, either in this course or also later, and get you started so that you are able to fend for yourself later on. Let us move on to conditionals. Python has a few mechanisms by which you can do conditionals, and it does not have too many, so it is actually very convenient. You do not have to remember a lot of things. The first is if else. In fact, probably the only one we are going to cover. The if else block, this is how the syntax goes. So, look carefully at this syntax. Over here, we have first assigned the variable a to the integer 5. The syntax says if a modulo 2, remember that this is the modulo operator, that a modulo 2 is equal to 0, then you specify the block inside the if along with this indentation. Typically, you will give 4 spaces. Okay. So, let me type this out, a is equal to 5, if a modulo 2 equals to 0, notice that to check for equality for integers, you use double equal to. Okay. Now, when I press enter, I press colon enter, it will automatically indent it. So, print even. The next line, if I want to get out of this if block, so if I print okay. So, I am still inside the same block. Now, I move back by 4 spaces, else print Now, in IPython, the way to get out is you hit one more return, one more return. If you print two returns, it will say, okay, you are done with this function definition, with this, with the definition of this block. So, I will revise. You have assigned A to 5, if conditional, in this case A modulo 2, this is evaluated, if that is equal to 0, it prints even, else, and remember the colon here, the colon is crucial, and remember that it is indented. Now, the thing here is, it is very clear to anyone who is reading this code, what this function block is doing. On the other hand, if I had some curly brace and all of this other stuff, which in other languages exist, it becomes much harder to read. It is one of the reasons why Python syntax is a lot easier to read in practice. So, notice that if A percentage 2 is 0, it executes this, if not it does this, standard straightforward stuff. The extra wrinkle that is there is if elif else. So, if I want to say else if, it is convenient to be able to use elif. So, if I say if A is greater than 0, print pause, backspace, elif A is less than 0, else, okay. Once again, only one block gets executed, then it depends on A. Now, the else is optional, so which means I could do very well have code like this, if user is equal to admin, do something, user is equal to moderator, do something else, elif user is client, do something else, and you can leave it hanging, that does not have to be an else block. So, if you do not need one, do not put one. Is this clear? I will revise. If conditional, this conditional should evaluate to true typically, true if this is to be executed, if it goes to false, it becomes this. You can also have an if elif saying if this, else if, read elif as else if. So, elif A less than 0, else this. Note that the else is optional. In addition, there is a very convenient ternary operator in Python. This is extremely useful. So, look at the following. First, we will read this very carefully. We have a string, the variable name for which is score underscore str. So, score str can be either AA, like what you see here, or score str could be a string of one of the numbers, say 99 or 100. Basically, this represents a student's score, right. So, if he is absent, that data record stores it as capital A, capital A. Now, what we want to do is, we want to convert this string to a number using int. So, it turns out that, this is something I have not shown you, int of, what is the type of this? Type of this will be string, correct? Open quote 90, close quote is string. But what is type of int of this? Integer. But if I did int of A, what do you think will happen? It should give me an error, because it does not know how to convert AA to a number, right. So, what I want to do is, we want to convert if this score str is AA, convert, set the score to 0, if it is not an AA, convert it using int. This seems like a reasonable thing to do. Does this make sense? So, score str is either AA or a string of one of the numbers in the range 0 to 100. We wish to convert the string to a number using int. So, you convert it to 0 when it is AA. This is the condition. So, if I wanted to write this with if L, I would simply say if score str is equal to AA, score equals 0, else score and now the score will be 100 because I said score str was this. Okay. So, this code block is kind of the same, I have done the slightly reverse of this code, both of these do the same thing, but you can see that it requires 4 lines. So, the ternary operator, you can express this in one line. I have simply made SS score str to make this line easier to, it was becoming too long. So, I have just saved it to another variable. So, I would read this as score is int score str if SS not equal to AA else 0. This is called a ternary operator. I will repeat what it is doing. The way to read it is to say if SS is not equal to AA, calculate this, else give me 0. This is called a ternary operator and it is extremely convenient when you need to do things like this. One thing you will see a lot in code is Python needs to use blocks which are indented to denote a block. So, for example, if I say A is 0, if A is greater than 0, print pass, else now supposing I do not want to do anything when I say print neg, and supposing I do not want to do anything in the else case, okay, I could either leave it or I could say pass, in which case it is syntactically valid. So, when I say else colon, I need to give it an indented block. If I leave it hanging, for example, if I did this, it will keep waiting for input, okay. I have to either control C or something, which means basically I have entered an else condition and I need to syntactically say do nothing. In that case you say pass. So, pass is what is called a syntactic filler, and when a certain block has no statements, a pass is thrown in. This is mostly when you are trying to prototype code. You are saying if something, if A is positive, put some comment and say pass, else pass. So, now I have written this block which gives me some structure. Later on I will decide to say okay, when A is positive I will write some code here, I will do some code here. So, basically it allows me to write a function structure or a the code structure and temporarily make it so that it runs, so that I can actually execute the code, and later on you will go and use it. Sometimes it is also used to make your code clearer. You want to say do something in this case, else do nothing. When you want to say do nothing, you use a pass. So, it has its uses in many places, you will see this if you are looking at Python code. So, do not worry about it, it is just to inform you of that. Let us move on to loops. So, notice that conditionals, there is only one, there is simply if else, there is no switch case or anything like that. Okay. So, it is extremely easy, and of course, switch cases can become a little painful to write because you have to write everything in the form of if elif, but it is not too bad because it is only one thing that you need to remember, there is only an if, you do not have to worry what case do I use here, should I use switch or should I use if, none of that botheration, you just write if. Next thing is loops, first one we will consider. So, there are a few mechanisms by which you can do looping, primarily there is while and for. So, the while loop is very straightforward, let us look at this example. So, this example prints squares of all odd numbers less than 10 using while. So, you initialize it by saying I is 1, while conditional colon is important, and then you give it a block that is indented. While I is less than 10, print I star I plus equals 2. What did I do wrong? So now this loop is running forever. I made a mistake. It's gone. It's just running. 3 3 3 3 3 is printing. So to get out of this, I hit Control C. Okay, and it kills that. So what did I do wrong? I said I plus 2. I missed the I plus equals 2. So let's do this again. Basically, the while loop executes as long as the condition is true, and you saw that I actually created an infinite loop. I never increment the counter, it ran off, in which case to exit from that I simply did Control C. Okay. So that is an important point to remember with the while loop. The other extremely useful iterator, that is the looping construct that is used in Python, is what is called for. So consider this little code example here: for n in 1, 2, 3, print n. You have seen this n in syntax before, this checks for existence, but in the for case, what this does is, it iterates over every element of this sequence, and remember this is a sequence. It can work for both lists, tuples, strings and other things that behave like sequences. I have only illustrated 3 of those. So for n in this, print n. So this will basically print 1, 2, 3. So let's try it. Remember to put the colon. If you forget the colon, it does not going to be a loop, it will be a syntax error. Let's try that. It says invalid syntax. Okay. You have to put the colon, print n. So one quick note, if you look at the error message over here, I will teach you one small, okay. So for n in 1, 2, 3 colon print n, this prints 1, 2, 3. So remember in the previous case when I typed this, I got a syntax error. Please note, if you look carefully at this syntax error, I have highlighted it here. Notice that in this line, it is showing this caret symbol here. So when you get an error message, please look at it very carefully. What this thing is saying is, at this point in this line, there is an error. Over here, there is an error. Therefore, you have to pay attention for n in. So it is actually telling you exactly which line, which column number in that line your error occurred. Okay. So it is good for you to pay attention to your error messages. One additional trick, if you notice the coloring for this is actually not very nice. Unless you have a bright enough monitor, it is not going to work. IPython has a color scheme. On the terminal, the current color scheme works best if your terminal actually has a black. For example, if I did this, when it is black, it looks very nice. But when it is white, it looks horrible. So you can either go to your edit profiles and change it, but unfortunately, if I use a black background, it may not be very clearly visible. So one way you can do this is, you change the profiles, edit, colors, and you change it to say white on black. Unfortunately, I cannot see the end of this. Oops. This is one possibility. The other is, if you do not want to do that, let me go back, edit, colors. You can do percentage colors question, oops, and you can set this to light BG, in which case you will get light colored background. Okay. But I am going to go with the current one, which is Linux, and I will stick to this color scheme. So if you are having problems looking at your error message, please remember I am insisting that you learn how to look at your error messages and pay attention to them. So let us make this mistake again. Now it is very clearly visible for me that on the console I typed something, line 1 may there is an error, for n in 1, 2, 3 at this point there is an error, I have missed the colon. So please pay attention to this. So let us move on. So we want to print the squares of all odd numbers less than 10 using for. So the way to do that is to say for n in 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, print n star n. So let us try that. And that works. The next line basically says for n in range 1, 10, 2, print n, n star n. So let us try this and see what we get. Let us first print n and see what we get, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Now let us do this, we get our answer. So you can clearly see that range is doing something interesting. So what does range do? How do we find out range? Question mark will help us. So range is, it returns, so it takes, look at the help documentation, it says range, optionally you specify a start, you must always specify a stop, and optionally specify a step. This returns a list of integers. Which is what it says, return a list containing an arithmetic progression of integers, range I comma j returns I plus 1, I plus 2 dot 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 to j minus 1. Remember, it does not really give you the last value, just like striding, just like slicing, okay. When step is given, it specifies the increment. So let us try this. So range of 4 will be 0, 1, 2, 3, range of 1 colon comma 4 will be 2, 1, 2, 3, range of 1, 4, 2 will be 1, 3, range of 1, 2, 3 will be 1, range of 4, 1 will be 0, because if starting index is gone too far, range of 4, 1 minus 1 will be 4, 3, 2, okay. So range basically takes you from optional start, stop, step. So range 1, 10, 2 starts from 1. Steps by 2, so we will get 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, returns a list and the stop value is not included, just like slicing, okay, consistent with the slicing. There are two very useful keywords that are used in Python that are extremely useful when you are doing looping. The first is break, the second is continue. So break basically breaks out from the innermost loop. So if you let's look at this with an example. So we are trying to calculate the squares of odd numbers below 10 using while and break. So what we do is we say I is 1, initialize the counter, while true, what does this mean? This will iterate forever, will it? Let's try, while true. Gone. It is an infinite loop, keep saying hello, 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 hello. To get out, I print control C, I keyboard interrupted it. So while true is going to loop forever doing this. It will print I star I, increment I by 2, but if I is greater than 2, it will break. So let us try this, I is 1, while true, print I star I plus equals 2. Okay. On the other hand, if I did not do this, it is going to keep going, okay, till the end of eternity, because remember these are long integers which have no size restriction. So till you exhaust the memory of your machine, it will keep going. So hit Control C to get out of this. Similar to break, there is also continue. What continue does is kind of like the inverse. With break, you are saying when this condition happens, get out of the loop. And remember, it will only get out of the innermost loop. So if I have two nested loops, okay. So for example, if I say for I in range 5, for j in range 5, if j is greater than 5, 2, break, print I comma j. Notice that in this case, I have nested loops. The code is extremely clear because I know that this if condition is only executed inside the for I and inside the for j. So, it is extremely clear what it is saying. If j is greater than 2, break. If not, or rather, otherwise, if you are not broken, you print I comma j. So, it does 0001 02. It will never hit 3 because 3 will break out of the j loop, but the break will not break out of the I loop, it will only break out of the j loop. So, notice that j goes all the way, I goes all the way to 4, but j always remains between 0, 1 and 2, okay. So, once again breaks out of the innermost loop. Continue on the other hand skips execution of the rest of the loop on current iteration. So, in this case, for n in range 1, 10, 2, if n modulo 3, so if n is divisible by 3, it will continue, otherwise it will just print the square. So, it prints the squares of all odd numbers below 10 that are not multiples of 3. Does this make sense? So, if n percentage 3 is 0, it will just continue, means it will skip to the end of the loop. So, it will not print this. So, when I say continue, it basically means skip this entire element. So, when n is equal to, for example, 3 or n is equal to 6, actually 6 will not come in this case, when let us say n is 3 or n is 9, they are both odd, n percentage 3 is 0, it will continue, which means it will not execute this print n into n for those cases. It will simply skip that and go back and start here. So, we have done basically conditional strings and loops so far. We can do lists really quickly, but before that I think it is a good idea for me to stop and ask for a few questions. So, if you have any questions, please raise them right away. If not, I will just quickly do lists. Any questions? If everything is clear, I have purposefully gone very slowly. Because today I am hoping to cover basic Python, but do it slowly and steadily so that you are able to follow all of the aspects. So, it does not look like anybody, okay. So, there is one question. Yes, please. Hello, please ask your question.
Hello, sir.
Yes, I can hear you.
Sir, I have tried that same code in the. Sir, I have tried the continue, tried the same code in continue.
Okay.
For loop with continue,
right.
Sir. It's
okay.
It's giving indentation error.
Yeah. So, what do you think indentation error is?
And the other thing, sir, when I'm typing the colon and going for the next line.
Yes.
Yeah, indentation is not happening defaultly, sir. I have to give a tab and again it's asking me.
Are you using IPython?
Again, I am typing it.
Are you
for
using
it's indentation is happening default.
Are you using IPython or are you using Python?
IPython, sir. IPython, sir.
So, how have you installed this? You are using the live
DVD? IPython only, sir.
Are you using the live DVD or are you using?
With the DVD, sir, with the DVD.
It shouldn't happen that way.
Live DVD, sir.
This is also the live DVD. It should work because I don't think anybody else is having.
Maybe any setting I have missed.
I don't think it's a setting thing. So if I do for n in range 4 colon and hit enter, it should immediately give me a indented line. If it does not, for whatever reason, if it does not do this. Yeah, you just give 4 spaces and now say print n. So, for example, let me do it, demonstrate it. So, let us say you got this, you do 1, 2, 3, 4, print n, give 4 spaces. If it does not work, please try it. If you have a problem, let us know. So, someone has asked the question, how do you decline, so does that answer your question? Maybe you can try it and raise a question on the chat window if you have a further problem.
Yes, sir, yes, sir. Yes, sir, it's working now.
Okay, great. Okay, so someone has asked, how do we define scope of the loop? Scope of the loop is always determined by the indentation. So, please look at this code for n in range 1, 10, 2, if n percentage 3 is 0, continue. All of this is indented one level. So, all of this is inside the for loop. Only the continue is inside this if. Therefore, everything is defined by indentation alone, which is why indentation is extremely important. And in your, if you are writing this in a text file, which we will look at soon, I would suggest you use spaces rather than tabs. And there are many editors which will automatically do this for you. If you type tab, it will automatically give you 4 spaces. Okay. I will recap range. There is a quick question. I will just take a question. Yes, St. Joseph's College from Kerala, please have ask your question.
Do loops work in the Python version? I am not using IPython, I am using Python.
Well, I strongly suggest you please install IPython, but yes, certainly, I mean for loops, all of this is basic Python, it has nothing to do with IPython. IPython is only a convenience. It is like saying, if I edit a C file, okay, I put for syntax in a C for syntax, it does not matter whether it is you edit it in Visual C Studio or you edit it in Vim or Emacs or gedit, does not matter. So, long as the syntax is valid, you are happy. So, it should work on Python, it should work on IPython. The only thing that will not work on Python is anything that is an extra feature like this question mark business, that is not actual Python, that is IPython doing some magic for you. Okay. So, there are certain things that IPython provides that are specific to IPython, but those are very often very obvious. What I am talking, all these slides are only talking pure Python. So, yes, the answer is it should work in pure Python also, unless you are typing something wrong. If it says indentation error, it means your indentation is neither consistent, is either not consistent or not correct. For example, if I say for n in range 4 and just give one line of indent, this will work. But in the second line, say I did print n star n, this will say wrong, because the first line may have given one line in one character indent, second line may have given 3 character indent, that is wrong. It has to be consistent, and this is one reason why Python code tends to be very readable. You cannot, it is illegal for you to have code that is badly indented. Does this make sense? It is one reason why it is easy to read Python code. Thank you. So, someone had asked me, so if you have another question, again, I am sorry, I am not being rude by shutting off your interaction, because if you do not have a further question, I am just going to move on because we do not have time. So, if you have another question, please just raise your hand again. I am not trying to be rude to you. Someone had asked a question about how you define range. So, you want to recap range. So, range basically says start, stop, step. So, if I say range of, so look at my terminal session, range of 1, 10, 2, it means start with 1, go to 10 minus 1 which is 9, step by 2. So, it will give me 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Supposing I did not specify this, just like in strides, it will give me by default the step is 1. If I did not specify 1, by default the starting point is 0. So, is this clear? So, range simply is kind of like the kind of like slicing. I mean, think of the syntax very similar to slicing. One more question, good question. What is the difference between pass and continue? I think it is easy to answer this yourself if you wrote a little bit of code. What pass will do is, it is simply syntactically, all it says is do nothing. Continue will skip everything in the rest of the loop. So, when I do, let me show you the continue case. Here, if I had put pass, it will still print n star n. So, the easiest way for you to answer your own question is to type in this code, run it with continue, see what happens, run it with pass, see what happens. This is how you learn and this is how you teach yourself. And this is extremely important because obviously I cannot teach you everything or answer every question. So, to answer your question specifically, if n percentage 3 is 0, if you say pass, it will basically not do anything for this if block, but it will execute n star n. But if I do continue, it will not execute anything below here inside this for loop. So, if I had print n star n, print hello world, print whatever else inside this for loop, it will not do it. Exactly. Pass is used for representing a null block.